Good evening. Welcome home to Most Precious Blood Catholic Church. Before our celebration begins, please take a moment to silence your cell phones. Thank you. Father Glenn Lopez will be presiding over our celebration this evening. Today, we will celebrate the sacrament of First Communion. To help maintain the reverence of the celebration, we ask that there be no photos during Mass. Please take a moment of silence in prayer. And now please stand and join in our gathering song.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our celebration of the fifth Sunday in Easter. And we're so blessed to have 12 beautiful children here who will be receiving the body of Christ for the first time. So this is, I think I'm more excited than them. To see them and just to be really be grateful and be happy that we now have the body of Christ and we receive through his blessing. Now we continue to receive Easter blessings, and Father Josh and I will go around and bless you with holy water.
Shall rise with him, dancing.
Almighty ever-living God, constantly accomplish the Paschal mystery within us, that those you were pleased to make new in holy baptism may under your protective care bear much fruit and come to the joys of life eternal. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When Saul arrived in Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was a disciple. Then Barnabas took charge of him and brought him to the apostles, and he reported to them how he had seen the Lord and that he had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had spoken out boldly in the name of Jesus. He moved about freely with them in Jerusalem and spoke out boldly in the name of the Lord. He also spoke and debated with the Hellenists, but they tried to kill him. And when the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him on his way to Tarsus. The church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria was at peace. It was being built up and walked in the fear of the Lord. And with the consolation of the Holy Spirit, it grew in numbers. The word of the Lord.
Shall serve him. Let the coming generation be told of the Lord, that they may proclaim to a people yet to be born the justice he has shown.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and truth. Now this is how we shall know that we belong to the truth, and reassure our hearts before him to in whatever our hearts condemn. For God is greater than our hearts and knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence in God and receive from him whatever we ask, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And his commandment is this: we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Those who keep his commandments remain in him, and he in them. And the way we know that he remains in us is from the Spirit he gave us. The word of the Lord.
You. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He takes away every branch in me that does not bear fruit, and every one that does, he prunes so that it bears more fruit. You are already pruned because of the word that I spoke to you. Remain in me as I remain in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit on its own unless it remains on the vine, so neither can you unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, because without me you can do nothing. Anyone who does not remain in me will be thrown out like a branch and wither. People will gather them and throw them into a fire, and they will be burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask for whatever you want, and it will be done for you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples." The Gospel of the Lord.
Good evening, everyone. It's good to see all of you here. Now, you notice that we have a little change in our seating arrangements, and more and more of our parishioners and friends and visitors could come and join us for the celebration of the Holy Eucharist and other church celebrations. So that's a beautiful thing. And of course, today is a reminder that we are God's people, and we continue to worship him as one. And as we sit here, we are united with the whole church. That's a beautiful thing. And it's the season of Easter, It's a season of new life, new beginning, a time of transformation, and a time of renewal of our faith in God through Christ. And it's so good to see that for the past couple weeks, we have been welcoming our first communion kids and candidates to receive the body of Christ. And this is such a beautiful gift to the church. It's also a beautiful gift for our parish. Many of us know Oscar Wilde. Oscar Wilde was one of the great literary geniuses of the late 19th century. He was very famous about the years 1880 to 1890s, and he was, of course, acclaimed as one of the best. Even today, people quote him a lot. He's a poet, he's a playwright, and he's also a journalist, and he was very prolific. He wrote many things, plays, narratives. He was also baptized Catholic, although he was first baptized Anglican, but his mother insisted that he be baptized a Catholic, so he was baptized Catholic, but I don't know much about his Catholic life, but yeah, he was Catholic. And what's striking about Oscar Wilde is that he has this penchant for parables, like telling stories like the parables in the styles of the gospel. And this is one example. He wrote, "One day, there was a man that went to a small town to the marketplace early in the morning. He sat down and began to raise his eyes to the sky and look up to heaven. Shortly thereafter, a man was walking by and passing. He was curious to see this man staring at the clouds or the heavens. And so he did the same. He stared. And soon after, people followed him. And a few hours later, there was a multitude of people gazing to the sky. And then once a large number of people were gathered, he slowly put his gaze down and stood up and said to everyone present, 'Amen, amen, I say to you, how easy it is to start a religion.'" It's so easy to start a religion. And it is a fact of life now in our modern society. Like, there are places that almost every corner you can see a church. And mind you, Christianity is the most divided church. Unfortunately, Jesus prayed for unity for the church, but we are, again, the most divided religion in the world. The question is, did Christ really intend to found a church? We can debate on that. Well, they say, of course. And the clearest sign of that is can be found in the Gospel of Matthew when Jesus said to Peter, I think it's Matthew 16, he said to Peter, "And behold, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church." But the question is it really a religion or a church that we know now? Did Jesus try to start a new religion? Others would say, no, I don't think so. He just appointed men, 12 of them, to be his apostles, to start spreading the good news. And I also know, and we all know, that Jesus was a faithful and devout Jew. And the plan of Christ, I think, was that the Jews would receive his message, and the message will go out from Jerusalem to the ends of the earth. Meaning, Jews will receive the good news of God's salvation, the coming of the Messiah in their midst. And then it will be our brother and sister Jews who will preach Christ to the world. But we know it didn't happen. We know it didn't happen. The plan was not materialized. And so they had to leave Jerusalem. As I was saying in my mass early this morning, I think, Jerusalem, where Christianity started, will not be a Christian city. never ever will be. Well, of course, there are Christians that live there. If you go to the walled city, the four divisions of the temple in Jerusalem, the walled city, the Armenians, the Christians, and of course, the Jews and the Muslims. But from there, it didn't really kind of, it didn't happen that Christian Jewish became, all of them became preachers of the good news. I think what Jesus came to do was establish a new covenant. And we know that. He said that several times. And this covenant is a new relationship with God. To renew that relationship that we have with God. It was not a new religion. Jesus didn't say, like, of course, like, we can start now organizing who will be the CEO, who will be doing this and that. He just had followers with him, inspired them by his words, his teachings, gathered them together. As a matter of fact, in today's gospel, it ends here by saying, by this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. He didn't say, and become members of my new church, become my disciples. Meaning, Jesus renewing the covenant that Yahweh had with his people, tried to enter into a special and personal relationship with God's people. The gospel of today is again a confirmation of that. He said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Signaling an intimate relationship that God wants to enter with us. There are many I am statements of Jesus in the Gospel of St. John. I am the resurrection and the life. Last week we have I am the shepherd. I am the gate. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the bread of life. But when he said, I am the vine and you are the branches, it signals a very important establishment of a new relationship and covenant with God. And that is a very, very personal one. And we can relate with that because all of us know plants, right? We just go out, you see those beautiful shrubs and trees and flowers there. It's very simple. It has a, like, the main trunk of a tree, and then it has branches and leaves. When Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches, meaning we have to be intimately connected with him so that apart from him, we will die. We can do nothing, nothing at all. Only in him can life and true life be sustained. And watch here when he said, I am the true vine. The first opening statement here, I am the true vine. The word true there is very important because many can pretend, I am he, follow me, listen to me. Those who start religions, right? Listen to me, I have the good news for you. But Jesus said, I am the true vine. Apart from me, you can do nothing. We have to be sustained by the grace, the mercy, and love of God in Christ. And thank God we have the church. Whether or not Jesus wanted this church to be this way that we have now, but I think it's also very important that we have to organize ourselves in a way that we are the church, the body of Christ. But here we are reminded that we have to look at him as the main vine, and we are the branches. And the church will continue to feed us with the nourishment, with the sustenance that will bring us and give us life. And thank God again for the church, that Jesus gives us this power and authority to dispense God's grace through the sacraments. And I look at the vine and the branches metaphor as something like, you know, we have, when you look at a tree or a vine, we don't have much of vineyards here, but when you look at a vine or a tree, you have like branches that are drying up and leaves that are getting more yellow. And you know that they will very close to dying and falling away. The same thing in our life as Christians. We know that although Christ is our main vine and we are the branches, we also know that we have many branches in our church that are getting weaker and drier and starting to fall away. But there is always hope. There is always hope. We can always find the grace and mercy of God in our life as Christians. And we have the sustenance of the sacraments. Today, we have all of these 12 children, and tomorrow as well. We have to remind ourselves that these children are the new branches of the church. They have to be sustained. We cannot allow them to wither away from the faith. And therefore, it is not only the responsibility of the church to take care of their growth in faith, but it is also the great responsibility of parents and their families to sustain that faith of these kids. We cannot allow them and their faith to wither away from Christ. We have to nourish that faith. Because religion is not a set of rules, it's not a code of conduct, or like a checkbox that, okay, oh, baptism, check. The next time you see the child is, okay, first communion, check. No, it has to be sustained constantly. Coming to Mass and receiving the sacrament of reconciliation are very, very important, because these are the ways that God's grace can be dispensed through us, through the church. And especially parents and families play a very important role for the growth of faith in these children of ours. I hope that every week we will see these children together with their parents, because a lot of times kids come and confess, and Father, I didn't go to church for 5 weeks now. What happened? Mom and Dad can't come. Like, it's always, they can't come here. They can't drive themselves here. Well, they can do Uber, but again, we don't trust Uber to bring them here. But they depend on you, parents. They depend on the families to bring them and to be nourished by the sacraments that we all share and receive in Christ. When he says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That means we have to stick with Christ. We have to be sustained by him. We have to form that family of a healthy vine. Today, the Lord Jesus Christ reminds us of this intimacy of his love for us. And he will always nourish us. But he also depends on us that, you know, we can choose not to be a part of it. We cannot wither away. We cannot die from our faith. We already have Jesus giving himself for us. Did Jesus start a religion? Again, the debate will continue. But what I know, what we all know, is that Jesus wants to enter into a personal and intimate relationship with each one of us, beginning with our children. Let us all please stand and let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the true vine, and his Father is the vine grower. Remain in Jesus and bear fruit in prayer for the needs of the world.
For the church, that we may continually draw life from Christ and bear a rich harvest of virtues and gospel values for God's glory, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the peace which God gives us may spread through nations involved in war, terrorism, and inner turmoil, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish, as we cultivate the seeds of faith in our community, that you send your Holy Spirit to challenge us to be selfless stewards in our efforts to continue to build your kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For parents, catechists, catechumenate leaders, and spiritual directors, that they continue to grow in their relationship with God so that they can support others as they grow in Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all communities overwhelmed by the COVID, particularly in India, that God will slowly spread the virus and give strength to all caregivers, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, may they remain in Christ forever, especially Reno Ayoka, Helen Ruth Arroyo, and Pedro Almaraz. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Our Mass is being offered for the people of the parish. Now we pray for our own private intentions, which we hold in the silence of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you are the living vine and we are the branches. Help us to remain in you always, just as you remain forever in your church. Prune from our hearts those things that prevent us from following you in freedom. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good evening. Father Glenn, Father Josh, brothers and sisters in Christ, we have in our midst 12 children who desire to receive Jesus Christ for the first time in the Eucharist. God has called them to his Eucharistic feast, and through the guidance of their parents, they have heard his voice and they have responded. It is my honor to present them to you. Children, when I call your name, please stand and respond, "Here I am, Lord." Emma Borman, Brock Brodsky, Lane Diello, Travis Del Judas, Brooks Ford, Samuel Freund, Peyton Junod, Zane Lichter, Isaac Long, Holly McDevitt, Ginger Ramirez, Amelia Ray.
So on behalf of Father Josh and the faith community of Most Precious Blood, I'd like to congratulate all of you, children and your families and your parents, for having come this far. I know this is a very important moment in your life, your faith life. And I remember my first communion as well. I have a black and white picture of myself, which is no colored pictures at that time yet, but just to be reminded that God loves you so much, and he wants you to be always a part of him and a part of the church. So we're here to support you. We're here to inspire you the best we can, and we're also here to pray for you and dedicate your life journey to the Lord with the blessing of the church. So once again, congratulations, and may you constantly be close to Jesus every single day through prayer and the sacraments. God bless you.
Children, you may be seated.
Pray now, my sisters and my brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Father Almighty. O God, who by the wonderful exchange effected in this sacrifice have made us partakers of the one supreme Godhead, grant, we pray, that as we have come to know your truth, we may make it ours by a worthy way of life. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Blessed is he
who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving you thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and John, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And may the peace of the risen Christ be with you always. Let us now offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. We will have our children for First Communion to receive the body of Christ first.
Sing to the Lord, alleluia, sing to the Lord, bless God's name, alleluia, sing to the Lord, alleluia, sing to the Lord, bless God's name, alleluia, sing to the Lord a new song, sing to the Lord all the earth, sing, announce his salvation day after day, tell God's glory among the nations, sing to the Lord, alleluia, sing to the Lord, bless God's name. Splendor and power go before him. Power and grandeur are in his holy place. Sing to the Lord, alleluia.
Sing to the Lord, bless God's name, alleluia.
Give to the Lord, you families of nations. Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. comes to govern the earth, to govern the world with justice and the peoples with faithfulness. Sing to the Lord, alleluia, sing to the Lord, bless God's name, alleluia. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Sing to the Lord.
I do not look for things to
I am the true vine, and you are the branches, says the Lord. Whoever remains in me and I in him bears fruit in plenty. Alleluia. Let us pray. Graciously be present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those you have imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Kindly be seated for some announcements.
Evening, everyone.
Good evening, Father.
So good to see you all here this evening. We'll have Eucharistic Adoration this Friday, May 7th, first Friday, from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. here in the Parish Life Center. So please come and spend some time with the Lord. Camper registrations for our Family Vacation Bible School, Rocky Railway, opens this Sunday, May 2nd, so please visit our website for more information on that to register. Last Saturday, I presented my plan for the next step of our campus development, and we're extremely grateful to our parishioners who have generously contributed to our debt reduction efforts. We had a lofty goal. Some have asked me, Father, what's the rush? This year we really are hoping to build no matter what, but in order to, with the next buildings that we want to build, we're really hoping to be able to build them, break ground, and have them built before it comes time to renew our contracts with our modulars. And we had this lofty goal that we kind of need to go in the next couple months if we're going to make that happen. Whether or not we make that happen, we're still hoping to build very soon. But we had this lofty goal of trying to raise $700,000 very quickly to reduce the loan on the Parish Life Center. Well, some of our parishioners have been incredibly generous. And so I'm just excited to share with you all that after just 1 week since we started trying to raise money, people are excited and really desire this. And so about $450,000 around that has already been raised. So, yeah. So we're very close. $250,000. This is so very attainable. And honestly, the $450,000, very small amount of parishioners so far, because we just started this effort, right? So that's, once we all start contributing, I really think, I mean, we could possibly raise even more than $700,000 and start already paying off, you know, future debt that'll help us get to our ultimate goal, which is a church. I was talking with somebody who, talking with a man yesterday, and he's one of our parishioners who, really, really generous tither. Really gives to where, not just from his excess, but makes sacrifices in order to tithe. And I was just talking to him about the spirituality behind that, and I said, you know, I'd love to see more people participate and just want to be a part of this. You know, we have a lot of really generous parishioners, but we have a whole lot of parishioners that don't really participate. And I asked him, like, what drives you? What advice would you give me? And he said, you know, Father, you know, I see you desiring that greater participation, you know, but even as you shared that for, he started criticizing me. He said, as you shared that for our Catholic appeal, he said, it almost sounded like, let's do this for Father Josh. And he said, no, I needed to hear this word, okay? I really did. And then he said, you know, and sometimes when we talk about our Catholic appeal, it's like, well, let's do this for the diocese, or sometimes it'll say, like he said, you know, like sometimes it's let's do this for even for this cause or that cause. He says, you know, at some point you really got to explain to people that it's really about doing this for themselves and for God. That's what all this is for. That they need to see that's what I saw that really changed everything for me. As we're trying to raise money for this effort, I just ask that you take that thought to prayer. That was interesting for me to consider. I mean, what we're doing here, we're paying off the debt of this building, which we use every single week. This is, you know, how the Lord feeds us. We're grateful for it, you know, and as we're paying off this, we're hoping to take out another loan to help us build, you know, buildings that are going to be the office building, but, you know, our future ministry space where we're going to come and encounter the Lord together, spend time for one another. You know, do we believe that God is asking this of us? So let's prayerfully consider how, you know, like, Lord, is this something that you're asking of me? And can we make that step of trust that when we are generous to God, that he's just going to bless us abundantly? But get excited. Awesome things are happening. The pledge envelopes. Do we have a pledge card in here? We do. Thank you. So you can always give on our website, okay? And the instructions are very easy to find to give online to this. But you can also pick up one of our pledge envelopes, and you can, from the narthex, you can complete it, and you can either drop that in one of the offertory boxes, or you can come by the parish office. So thank you so much for supporting this effort, and especially special thank you to all those who've already given so generously. We're so grateful, and we're trying to build buildings. I am going to, just warning, I'm going to be talking about money for a couple weeks, you know, but then I promise to stop for a while, okay? So, but thank you guys for everything that you do and for loving this place. And, oh, if you received your first communion today, please stand up so we can congratulate you.
Thank you, Father Jess. And once again, congratulations to our children here, their families, and of course to our parish. Beautiful addition to our faith community. Please all stand. The Lord be with you. May the Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Thanks be to God. Our prayer to Saint Joseph. Hail, guardian of the Redeemer, spouse of the Blessed Virgin Mary. To you, God entrusted his only Son. In you, Mary placed her trust. With you, Christ became man. Blessed Joseph, to us too, show yourself a father and guide us in the path of life. Obtain for us grace, mercy, and courage, and defend us from every evil. Amen.